After flying across the mountain range, the waterfront was our first view of the beautiful city of Cape Town, with a slumbering seal on the deck. Without a car, we decided a bus tour was a good way to find our way about and see the people. Cape Town is a very modern city, curled around the bay, with sandy beaches and tempting waters. Creative locals invited tourists to buy their creations. What did you do in Zimbabwe?
The clothing factory.
Is that a restaurant?
No, a clothing factory.
Do you make these?
Yeah, I make it myself. I start to make these when I come here. Yeah. Yeah, they take a lot of patience there.
The tour bus was a good idea, as you could get off at any of the stops to look further and then catch the next bus. The wharf was a lively area full of tourists. Music caught your ear everywhere, played by these talented locals. Ostrich eggs caught my eye as a must-buy, but it was hard to choose. I only have room in my bag for one. We decided to try the local food and shared several dishes with our Cape Town friends. They are recently married and are sharing their accommodation with us.
That is my time a bit of the...
No, your right hand's fine.
Just remember that.
Good to share. You get the pay.
Yeah.
Smiling now. I should take my glasses off.
Today, we will investigate Table Mountain, which towers over Cape Town. We were warned, however, not to stray from the path, as we might be mugged. We joined the throng of tourists and admired the incredible view of the sprawling city. We then headed to the surf to cool off. Justine and Noel went straight into the surf, but Steve just watched them. Nanette's family decided to take us for a drive to Hoot Bay. It's a wild, stormy day today, so we settled for a local fish experience in a warm restaurant. Then, back to the wharf to view more of the local creative work. I want to buy everything I see, but our 22 kilo luggage allowance is very limiting.
From Tanzania, East Africa. What I'm doing here, we call marquetry and pyrography. It's a combination of two different art. We call pyrographic marquetry.
And you actually do this yourself, you were telling me the other day. So how do you do it?
First we do inlay, like any other wood inlay marquetry. All these are different pieces of wood inlaid. And then we sit down with the machine, After that, we draw with a pencil to get the details. Then we do wood burning. We call pyrography.
And you are now using...
What I'm using now is a wood burner. It's a wood burner.
So you highlight some of the areas.
Yeah, so the wood burner, we control temperature on the wood burner. And we change tips also, depends on what we're doing. Yeah, some wood are hardwood and some of them are softwood.
I think it's
very, very
colorful.
Thank you very much.
I hope Miss Anshina got you there. And now, will you allow me to film some of your...
Oh yeah. I got different types. This here is marquetry. Oh, thank you very much.
Yes.
This is marquetry. It's only wood inlay.
Right.
The front here.
I'll go around.
Cherry wood.
Cherry wood, yes.
This is a common.
Yes.
This is an egret. This is a walnut, American walnut, black.
Where do you get your wood from? Here?
Yeah, we get here in South Africa, but some of them we import from West Africa and East Africa and Central Africa.
And do you live Cape Town?
Yeah, we live in Cape Town. Never been school of art, just imagination from our grandfathers, who was a carpenter. Yeah, they are from northern part of...
Creative.
Good. Looks like an elephant.
So that is a different colored wood, is it?
Different color of wood, yeah. Right. And this one, right here, cherry wood.
Right.
You can find some elephant like this one in Kenya.
Kenya?
Because of the clay.
Yes.
But this is most popular elephant.
Yes. Where are you from? Yes. How long have you been in South Africa? 8 months.
A smooth flight over the mountain range from Cape Town to Windhoek takes 2 hours, and we are soon organizing our four-wheel drive home for the next 6 weeks.
So you check everybody's car, right?
Yeah.
I hope ours is checked out and it goes well.
Okay.
Thank you. We are here at the airport getting instructions how to use the car. There's a bit of a stuff up to start with, and we got one without a bed. That has all been changed. We now have one with a bed. How I open it, I have no idea. Hopefully, we will find out.
Everything in the four-wheel drive had to be checked and counted. Knives, forks, spoons, sleeping bags, etc. It's actually very well equipped, even down to wine glasses. But it all took ages, and the sun is well up and blazing down on us. But it was rather fun checking our new home. I soon discovered that Noel was much more familiar with erecting a tent than our instructor, even one on top of a vehicle. Driving from the Windhoek airport, we wondered if we were headed in the right direction to find the city. It all looks so deserted and flat, just a few stick-like trees scattered on the desert horizon. Later, we discovered Windhoek. It's a relatively modern city, similar to some of our larger Aussie outback towns. A mix of old and new.
Which is where it still is.
They call traffic lights robots.
The craftwork in the City Square Market invited a much more thorough examination later. We had our first encounter with the Himba women in the shopping arcade.
We soon found our lovely friend and travel guide, Jules, who has organised all her favourite Namibian places for us to visit. It's not a trip for the faint-hearted. It's 6,500 kilometres on uncertain roads with a 6-week deadline, and we are camping. Here I am in Windhoek, and I'm... Talk about map reading. I will tell you just one of the intricate directions to Zebra Lodge. How to find us. From Windhoek, follow the B1 to Rehoboth, take the C24 through Kleinborg, pass the lapel turnoff, and continue on the MR47 to Rietalk. Take the D1206 in direction Noordkloof, left at the T on the C14, then right on the D854 and left on the D850 to our gate, 19 kilometres on the right. Lodge is 5 kilometres down the track. That's just one of the directions. We have game lodge names and a map to guide us.
The next morning, we are up early to leave Windhoek on the way to our next adventure.
That's it.
Namibia seems to be cut up into animal conservancies and game lodges, and just a few scattered farms. Petrol stations are few and far between in Namibia, so we always top up. We need cash, or rand, should I say, also to pay. No bank card facility here. Noel fills up, and I go and chatter to the girls in the cafe. English is the required language here, but even the illiterate are bilingual. They all speak English, German, and Afrikaans. Education is compulsory here in Namibia, but it costs 70 rand a term. Well, this is very, very difficult for the villagers, as that's a lot of money for them. So mostly the kids do not go to school. The book tells me there are many different weaver species. Some build a single nest, as we see here, but they are in close proximity to all the others. Bart, the sociable weaver, he builds a huge collective apartment. This is maintained by all its inhabitants. This method, of course, insulates the nest so they are protected from the heat of the day and the cold desert nights. I hear some of the apartments are over a century old. We arrive at Bagatelle in time for a very late lunch. We're having our first meal in the Kalahari Desert. We have booked into the lodge, which is probably about 2 kilometres away down the red track. And we have our own amenities just right next to where the car is parked. We soon mastered the tent erection for our first night under African stars. I am in. Wow. An open truck picked us up for a game safari to investigate the animals on the property.
Usually when it rains, they come out and they're quite fresh. And when they're fresh, they release a very strong scent of smell. And that smell, it used to attract insects. So what used to happen to the people who used to live here, the bushmen, so to prevent themselves, because even in this area, there are mosquitoes as well. Even though they're not malaria problem, but they used to be mosquitoes. So what used to happen, they'll collect a lot of this, they'll put it on their around the bed when they sleep. So when the mosquitoes come, instead of going to them, they get attracted by the smell. Then they'll go to the plant. Now if you can look, it's got like little holes. Then they'll just go there, keep smelling, and then they go deep, and then they don't come out.
This place is on the edge of the Kalahari Desert, with miles of red dunes all running parallel. The lower valleys in between are called streets, and this is where the animals feed in the long grasses. We soon discovered that a sunset drink, a sundowner, is a way of life here in Namibia, and the choice of drinks would be a credit to any city bar. I am not into getting a meal at our camp tonight. It's been a long day. so we booked into the game lodge for a magic evening al fresco under the stars. We had a visitor for breakfast, a young springbok. I think he's a family pet, as he was chased out of the game lodge yesterday. His horns have hose pipes over them. Probably because he is such a friendly little fellow, he is likely to rip you with his sharp horns when he rubs around you. Next morning, after a quick breakfast in camp, we headed back to the lodge for a game drive, looking for cheetahs. But they soon found us. They walked around the open truck and inspected us very carefully. There are several cheetahs here. I wondered if they were considering me for lunch. I felt very exposed and hid behind my camera. Cats, cheetahs and leopards are hated by the farmers as they kill their stock, so they generally are shot. There is a big move at the moment to save the cats, and there are several organisations who will catch the errant cat and place it at a suitable game lodge. Bagatelle is one such lodge, which has sufficient fenced area to let the cat live out a normal cat life. These lodges are sometimes a few hundred kilometres. Every plant here seems to have prickles on it. The only one I know that can really handle it is the giraffe, and he licks his way very, very carefully round the thorns and gets the juiciest fresh leaves. Some of the accommodation lodges are dotted up on the Red Hill with a game-watching lodge next door. The valley is probably lit up at night for a bird's eye view of the night predators. Leaving Bagatelle, we met an ostrich family. And as we glided towards the gate very quietly, we accidentally separated the chicks from their parents. But one brave baby soon led the way around the car and they wandered off into the bushland. We are on the way to Zebra River Lodge, which is about a 5-hour drive. I had a surprise phone call yesterday from Marianne Fields, who owns this lodge. She asked if we could buy apples, bananas, lettuce, and cucumbers on the way to their place. We wondered where on earth in this deserted desert we would find a supermarket. However, Marianne assured me there was a shop about halfway. No handy corner shops here. We discovered that shopping for all the game lodges is hours away. So shopping has to be very comprehensive. I am here at Zebra River Lodge. We have been travelling since Bagatelle, which it's a fair bit further down the road. We're really pretty much in desert country here, but all of a sudden at the River Lodge we're in a canyon with a multitude of colours, and I am going to talk to the owner of this place and just find out a little bit of why they are here.
Marianne Field. I was actually born in Holland, surprisingly enough, but grew up in South Africa, and I've been living in Namibia now for, how many, 17 years actually. And I was working in Windhoek, and then we wanted to visit this area. My husband loves hiking and he loves the mountains and so on, so we happened to see this place was for sale, and we've been thinking along the lines of doing something together, working together, and so we came and had a look. Really, when I first saw this area, it was very dry. It'd been a drought for.
I thought it was dry today.
No.
It gets drier.
Yes, it was very dry. I still said to Rob, "Oh, it's so inhospitable. I don't know if I could ever live here." But so we came. We saw the springs on the property, which are absolutely beautiful. And a year later, we came back. It was still for sale. It got dropped in price a bit. And we went up onto the high ground, and that was superb. If you look out from the plateaus, I just felt such a sense of. I never thought before about owning land or having land, like a Redinian said, you use the land, and it's just incredible. So that pushed me, those views pushed me into agreeing to the whole process of moving here and just really enjoying it, and working together and having our own business, and it was really great.
That's lovely. Could you tell me what you offer the tourist? You could be
Basically we say we're a destination within ourselves because there's so much to do here in terms of walking and hiking and just enjoying the landscape and the birds and so on, and we're very interested in geology and archaeology as well. We've had a couple of caves which have been excavated. And they found one of the earliest shelly fossils here. So for people who are interested in that, and of course for bird watchers and stargazers, there's something to do. And then just to sit and relax in this lovely landscape. But also we're quite central because you can get to us from Uderitz, from Swakopmund, and from Windhoek as well. And nowadays they've opened the Matematik gate, so from Matematik, Kalahari, Kempswell part as well. So yes, and you can visit Sausage Flay, of course.
What happens when it really rains?
When it really rains, it's actually surprising because you can hear the river coming down, all the boulders sort of making a huge racket.
Can you get out?
Well, for a few hours you may be stuck, but generally within a few hours you can get through the 4x4, perhaps not a small car, but obviously with a 4x4 usually. In fact, this year we had very heavy rains and we had to use our Unimog a couple of times to to get in here. So, but you never feel that you're going to be stuck for days. It's a matter of hours in Namibia because the water runs away so quickly.
We have been very intrigued with it, and we will look forward to having a look at your place and investigating the hills.
Perfect. Yeah. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
We are on top of the world. We are just above Zebra River. And we are at a lodge just down on the right. And we are just... what can I say?
Waiting for sunset.
Yes, we are waiting for the sunset. But we've been watching the baboons play on the cliffs, which was just so gorgeous. There's a canyon right over to the right. And there is one tree. And it's just sitting there. There are many photographic opportunities here, but anyway, here's to a sunset in Africa.
Quite a lot of time here at Zebra River Lodge. Could you tell me how did you arrive here and why have you stayed?
Well, briefly. I came as a visitor 6.5 years ago, and with a group of friends, international group. We've been friends 30 years this year, and we have reunions every 3 years somewhere in the world. And we booked this lodge 3 years in advance to have the whole lodge for a week, because one couple come every year since they've opened. And so I came, went with them as well around the country, and fell in love with the country, you know, and the people here are amazing.
So you have stayed and you work here?
I've been here 6 years now, and I do massage work and artwork, and cover in the office when Marianna's away, like today.
And yes, they've gone shopping,
yes,
haven't they?
Shopping.
But shopping is quite a jaunt from
here,
isn't it?
It's a four-hour drive to the grocery store and every other store, banking, post, everything, yeah. So they'll come back with toothpicks only fitting into that Land Rover and trailer. Yeah, no, it's been amazing. I'm actually leaving the country next week, but I'm taking a full heart. It's been an amazing experience.
It's just wonderful. Where do you think you'll go next?
Well, my layover is in Greece, where I lived for 10 years, and so I'll be there for...
You have a home there.
I have a home there. And
has it been minding itself?
No, I've had renters in there for 8 years, and it just happens, coincidence, haha, that they're moving out right now. Yes, yes. So then I'll go stay in my own home, which I haven't been in for years and years, and do some work on the house and finish writing a book. I'm working on a book about grieving, and I'm going to finish the book, finish an edition, so I'm just going to do some finishing up, and then go to the States and look for my new perch. I'm going to get a used camper van and paint it purple and do a walkabout to find a wonderful place. But I'm also thinking, in this in-between time when I'm disconnected, what other possibilities could open? So I'm looking at opportunities of that in-between time. So maybe work on a cruise ship, doing massage work or run the spa or something like that. So I'm open for ideas.
You're an amazing person. Could you, tell me your full name?
Gail Saunders.
Thank you very much.
Oh, pleasure.
Do you make all the food here?
Yes.
Wow, you are very, very clever.
I love your hair.
I was very intrigued with this lovely young lass's hair, so I asked her how it was done. She gave me a very comprehensive talk on the process, but unfortunately, my camera picked up the noise of a generator or some machine or other and drowned her out. But it seems to me to be a very complicated procedure. There are many such hairdos here in Namibia with fashionable young ladies.
With the shape of your face, are you a particular tribe or a particular area of living here?
Yes, we are living in southern area of Namibia. Mm-hmm. We are Namas.
The Namas.
Yes,
you are the Namas.
Yes.
The houses built on the way here were built in a beehive type along the road, a long way back, and we wondered, were they of a particular tribe of people? They were the Namas, perhaps, were they? There were about six of them, a long, long, long way.
No, we are originally not from that houses. Namas are also huts. They make huts. They make of wood. They make it like this. Like, not like this, but they are making like this.
I see.
Yes. And they are also using clay on the floor and the cow dung from the cows and the sheep and the goats take it out, yes, to clean it out, yes.
Do you have a particular language? Do you have that clicky language?
Yes.
Can you say something to me in that language? What did that say?
It's, let's go to the dance. Yeah, it's yes to juice. All both four languages of both four clicks. It's four clicks.
Can you say something else to me? Could you tell me who you are in that language?
Tideke anama. Tideke always I say sadist in Namada. Sadist are hudeke kuya.
Oh, that's incredible.
Yes.
Do you, you would learn that language, of course, with your family home?
Yes, we are speaking Namibia at home. It's our home language.
Right.
Yes.
I see. Say something else to me. I'm fascinated.
Oh.
How come? What did you say to me?
I am very glad to meet you. Yes, I'm very glad to meet you. Especially the foreigners which is coming in. They are nice to us.
Yes. Of course they would be. You are nice to them.
Yeah.
It is a privilege for us to come to you and to talk to you and have you greet us because I consider people are the same the world over.
Yes.
We just have different parents and that is pure chance.
Yeah.
Pure chance. How come you are at this particular house working here?
Working here. First my mom was working here.
I see.
Yes, I come to visit her, and Marianne asked me to work here.
Yes. How long have you been here?
First time before I married, I was here, and after I'm getting married, I'm going, and then I'm coming back, and when I'm coming back, after I'm coming back, it's now 4 years.
I see. And you have three children, one in school, and how old are the others?
I have three children, three girls. Two are at school. Mm-hmm. Yes. The first one is 9 years, and the second one is seven. Mm-hmm. Yes, last one is 2.5.
Oh, that's just lovely news. Yes. Did you tell me your name?
Anna.
Anna.
Yes.
Thank you very much, Anna. That is just lovely.
Yeah.
There you go. That's...
My name is Yana Veresova.
Oh, that's a good one, and that is not a local name, so tell me where you come from.
I come from Slovak Republic.
How long have you been here?
I've been here 6 years, and I just came after 1 year again back. Year I haven't been.
Well, did you come here on a holiday and stay also?
Basically, yes. We met in Switzerland with Mariana and Rob, and they just invited me. I was supposed to come for 3 months, and it's just a long 3 months almost. Yes. So, yes, yeah.
Oh, that's lovely.
Yeah.
Thank you very much indeed.
I'm in the middle of the road, in the middle of Namibia. And it's so quiet and so lonely. Actually, only 2 million people live in Namibia, so it's rare that we ever come across anybody. So we drive, and these wonderful purple hills, or else it's rolling savanna, and it's just us. It's a very, very different experience, and very warm experience with the people that we do come across. We're down at one of the river camps that you can camp and stay at. But even at the river camps, when camping, they give you your own accommodation, generally in separate blocks, with hot water, gas-fired hot water, and your own basin, and lock up a corral, shall we say. Over on our right, we have a sort of, are they hens?
Sort of like a guinea fowl.
I feel today that we are somewhere way back in the beginning of time, perhaps a millennium ago, with the strata of the mountains. We are actually, I think, still in the Tsarist Mountains, and you can see how they are formed in stratas. But it has a timeless quality. It's really quite incredible being here. Hill after hill, the mountains unfold. They are a purpley colour and a golden colour. I haven't seen any animals this morning, though.
This is bulk limestone of the Tsarist Mountains, and the runnels in this are where the water runs over it when it rains and dissolves out the calcium carbonate.
Is that more clearly visible in this one?
This is a much more startling example of the same erosion.
Behind me now, there is an alluvial fan where the sand and debris washes down out of the gullies and the hills and makes this fan-shaped flow of sediment. And standing up through the flow of sediment, you can see three or four small hills.
Where is the actual flow coming from?
The flow comes from on the high mountains, down the gullies, and there's no pronounced river up there, so it just spreads out over the countryside, just spreads all out. It's a big fan-shaped thing. 1 year it'll flow down one way, another year it'll flow down another way. So it just builds up this huge conical sort of fan.
So does this form the actual terrain in layers as I see it?
Well, what's happening is that the layers in the hills are being eroded and they're building up other layers down here now. And this is all mixed up because it's some sandstones and some limestones. But here, the rocks are all mixed up, whereas in the hills, they're in definite layers. In this area over here, you can actually see two of the gullies with very prominent pile flows of sediment coming down off the hills.
Thank you.